The Pittsburgh Penguins are having a really tough time right now. As of this filming, they are on a 6-game winless streak, their last win coming on December 20th against the New York Rangers. That was nearly 3 weeks ago. But teams go on losing streaks all the time. It's not uncommon to see a team go on a 6-game losing streak. In fact, 16 of the 32 NHL teams went on 6-game losing streaks at least once last season. Two of these teams ended up making the playoffs. For the Pens, it's not about the fact they've been losing these games, but more about how they have lost these games. And the fact that they have all been subsequent losses definitely doesn't make the situation feel any better. The Pens' month of December started off with a bang, quickly going on a 7-game winning streak, defeating top teams like the Stars and the Vegas Golden Knights. Their first loss of the month came on December 18th against the Canes, but they soon won the next game against the Rangers only 2 days later. This is where it all went downhill. On December 22nd, the Pens were scheduled to play their third game of the season against the Carolina Hurricanes, of which the Canes had already won two of the previous matchups, one in regulation and one in overtime. The Pens opened the scoring late in the first period with a power play goal from Sidney Crosby. That lead would quickly go away, however, as Martin Natchez would score only 15 seconds later to tie the game at 1-1. Only 17 seconds after this, Jalen Chatfield scored his first career NHL goal to send the Canes to the first intermission with a 2-1 lead. Jari was screened, so it's not a terrible situation, but this is an easy stop for most goalies when they can actually see the puck. The second period stayed scoreless until a shorthanded goal by Brock McGinn, and the third period featured goals from Bryant Rust and Jordan Staal to tie the game at 3-3 and send it to overtime, in which the Pens lost only 23 seconds in on a perfect tic-tac-toe play. Brent Burns nearly put himself offside, which makes this loss a bit more tough to swallow. But still, the Pens came away with a point. But if they only knew what would lie ahead of them the next few games to come. On December 27th, the Pens and the Islanders faced off for the first time this season at UBS Arena. And to say the Pens were completely dominated would be an understatement. They were outshot 21-42 and were limited to only 4 shots in the second period and 5 shots in the third. 4 different Islanders had multi-point nights, and both Anders Lee and Matt Barzal picked up a pair of goals. This game was really tough for the Pens. They had to simply dust themselves off and bring the energy to the next game. The next day, the Pens faced off against Detroit at home and were looking to improve from their performance from the previous day. And oh boy, did they. The Pens opened the scoring with Drew O'Connor's first of the season and then quickly took control of the game with a power play goal from Jeff Carter and a pair of goals from Jason Zucker. By the end of the first period, 4 different Pens had multi-point nights and it looked like they were going to sail to an easy victory. However, in the second period, Dylan Larkin was able to get the Red Wings on the board with a power play goal, and then Joe Valeno cut the lead in half on a weird play between Crosby and Ruda where Crosby gives Ruda his stick even though they shoot from opposite sides. Still, heading into the third, the Pens had a 4-2 lead, so the Red Wings had a lot of ground to make up. With 5 minutes left in the period, Jonathan Berggren scored to make it a 1-goal game after Crosby poke-checked the puck right to him. A tough goal to give up, but the Pens still had the lead. As long as they don't take any penalties, this should be an easy... Well, the Pens get a bench minor for too many men. Okay. Well, the Pens have the best penalty kill in the league, so this shouldn't be too hard to... I guess I spoke too soon. 11 seconds into the power play, David Perron scores to tie the game. Remember those 2 power play goals from the first period? Yeah, those were both because of penalties Perron took. So this was a little bit of a redemption for him. Good for him, I guess. Alright, tie game with 3 minutes to play. Let's just hope the Pens can send this to overtime and get a point out of this. Luckily, they do. And they have the ability to get the extra point that they've been wanting to get from the beginning of the game. In OT, Andrew Kopp misses a wide open net to keep the game alive for the Pens. And to their credit, the Pens really put effort to win to this game. Kopp redeems himself after 2 minutes of overtime with a perfect pass off of Jake Wallman's stick to win the game. Wallman hits the critty right after this goal, as he should, and it's pretty sick. The Pens leave the ice, and the feeling couldn't have been too great, but they did get a point. Hopefully they can clean things up against the Devils next game. It is December 30th, the last game of the 2022 calendar year for the Pens, and they want to end the year on a good note. They are playing the Devils, which as of late have been struggling. At this point, the Devils were 1-7-1 for their last 9 games and hadn't beaten a Metro team since December 3rd. This game had some weird moments. Like this goalie interference call where it appears Joseph pushes Holla into Jari just a little bit? I don't know. I think this call could have gone either way, but since the officials on the ice initially waved off the goal, that had more weight in the review process. So something finally did go the Pens' way, but only a few minutes later, the Devils scored a power play goal to tie the game, and were subsequently put back on the power play after the Pens were assessed a bench minor for unsportsmanlike conduct for abusing an official. Wow. The Devils didn't score on this power play, though. Oh, and speaking of penalties, the Pens had 9, yes, 9 power play opportunities this game and didn't score on it a single time. They even had a 4-minute double minor penalty for high sticking with 11 minutes left in the game and still couldn't score to tie the game at 3-3. As if this wasn't bad enough, the game-winning goal was a shorthanded goal on the Pens' 6th power play opportunity of the game. If you're doing the math, the Pens' power play this game had a goal differential of -1. Yikes. Since the power play opportunity stat was recorded, there have only been 2 other instances of a team having 9 power play opportunities and not a single power play goal. Needless to say, this was a super embarrassing performance by the Pens and their special teams. It's now January 2nd, and we are in the new year. The Pens have a chance to start this year off with a clean slate and forget the past 5 games that have probably been haunting their dreams by now. Not only is it game day, it is game day at Fenway Park at the Winter Classic. The hype is high, and the Pens are about to face off against the best team in the NHL on a national stage. The first period is scoreless, but the Pens come out with a strong offense with 14 shots on goal. And after the first 20 minutes, the Pens' expected goals total is a little over 1, but Ullmark was being Ullmark. Kasperi Kapanen opens the scoring in the middle of the second period off of a great feed by Danton Heinen, and things look pretty good for the Pens going into the third period. Jake DeBrusk would tie the game 8 minutes into the third, and then he would score again with 2:30 to go in regulation to give the Bruins a 2-1 lead. So far, this hockey game is going pretty normal, beside the fact that it's being played in a baseball stadium. But the hardest part about this game for Pens fans to swallow is how close they were to tying it. About 0.5 seconds after the game had ended, Malkin shoots it past Ullmark to reach netting. At first, it looks like the Pens might have tied the game, but the officials are confident that the time had expired. The Pens were less than a second away from going to overtime. But as this video has clearly demonstrated, the hockey gods just simply aren't on their side right now. While not an embarrassing or bad loss by any means, the Pens just had to keep their head up and play the next one. Who are they playing next anyway? Oh. It is January 5th, and the Pens are in Vegas trying to find their first win of the 2023 calendar year. The Vegas Golden Knights have been great this season, but at home, they were a measly 10-10-0 coming into this game. The Pens would hope to use that to their advantage, but they also knew they had something else to worry about. And they had to worry about Jack Eichel. It was his first game back in 11 games, and you know he was hungry to play some hockey, and he did just that. In the first period, the Vegas Golden Knights quickly took a 3-0 lead with goals from Kessel, Eichel, and Stevenson, Eichel also tallying an assist. In the second period, scoring was low until Mark Stone scored with only 11 seconds remaining in the period. Eichel recorded another assist. After the full 60, the Knights won 5-2 after the Pens failed to come back, though Ty Smith scored his first of the year, so there is at least that, I guess. While this loss wasn't anything out of the ordinary, I'd say it was especially frustrating for Pens fans, since the Pens controlled the puck for almost the entire second period. They dominated play for the entire second period, and still couldn't score a single goal, and in fact let up that one goal to Mark Stone. As I'm putting the final touches on this video, the Pens finally snapped their 6-game winless streak today with a win over the Arizona Coyotes. While this streak was not the longest, I'd argue that it was definitely the worst streak of the season given all of the details I discussed today. What do you think were the worst parts about this losing streak? And do you think that another losing streak was as bad or even worse as the ones that the Pens just experienced? Let me know in the comments below. I really appreciate you watching this video, and stay tuned for more content like this.